great respect for the Word of God, and he studied the Scripture. He was a Sunday school teacher at his own Baptist church for many years in Duxbury. It's where I met my lovely wife, who helped give us these two amazing kids. And so my dad's legacy lives on, and if you read the obituary, you'll realize that baby Anderson, Amanda, is expecting, so it's all good. One goes out, another comes in, so... And that's good. And my dad was able to give Amanda and Zach his congratulations, and that was awesome. My dad was so tender, kissed Amanda's belly, and I'll never forget it because that baby is in the works, and I can't wait. I'm so happy for you guys. He's going to look just like Grandpa Bill, and you better name him Bill, okay? All right, no Zach. He's excited too. All right, so let me just go back into the book of Hebrews for just a few moments. When a verdict is in, I'm calling this message today, The Evidence Stands. When a verdict is in, it's after all the evidence has been presented. The jury has finished convening and they give their final statement. We, the jury, find the defendant guilty or not guilty, right? So the evidence is in. And we like to think that we still live in a country that offers people fair trials, and we all like to think if we're ever accused of a crime that the evidence would show forth that either if we're not guilty, that we're not guilty. My dad was a fan, and I was at his house yesterday. It's funny, I feel like, you know, with everything in place at my dad's house, I'm like, it's like sacred, like the DVD collections. His clothes are so neat. I open his closet door, and I start crying. I'm like, this doesn't feel right. I never would go in his closet. He was so orderly. But in one of my searches yesterday, I came across a Perry Mason DVD. He was a big Perry Mason fan. Often when I'd come over to his house, he had MeTV on. How many MeTV fans here? Yeah. You classic people. You're the real deal, right? You would love my dad. So anyway, so I was thinking about this idea of what Hebrews is an incredible, incredible rich presentation of facts, okay? It is factual. It is so precise in what Jesus did that the writer wants you to know, and the writer ultimately is the Holy Spirit. The writer wants these truths to be so impressed upon the Hebrew people, the Jewish people, and we get the benefit of this living testimony of what God did. But my dad was a lover of Perry Mason, and he loved the idea of always watching how Perry would make his defense, and he was an incredible attorney, and then the verdict was presented. I want you to watch a moment that would have been occurring in my dad's living room.
Now, there's only one person in this case or connected with it who would have ready access to that kind of cash at that time of night. Now, who was it you saw coming out of your room right after you heard that shot?
Sterling, Lucky Sterling.
Yeah, me. Lucky Sterling. I killed him.
All right. Why is everybody named in the 1950s shows Lucky? Okay? There's always something like, you know, Snipes, or, you know, you've got these clear names of somebody who's like, they're already in trouble because of their name, right? What's Muggsy? There you go. Thanks, Bill. Okay, well, the book of Hebrews is much like a courtroom setting, presenting all the evidence about Jesus. And we listen and we understand and we accept the findings of God's evidence and the proof of his testimony to this world. Hebrews gives us a lot of grace. J. Vernon McGee points out, and I believe I left it over here. This one didn't make the Google Drive for some whatever reason. But J. Vernon McGee points out, this is what happens in the life of every Christian. Okay, this is not just the Hebrew people, this is you. And the book of Hebrews keeps one very important thing in mind. God is relating to humans, okay? But the Bible actually says later in the book of Hebrews that Jesus Christ sympathizes with every one of your weaknesses. Jesus sympathizes with my grief right now. That to me is amazing. Why does Jesus sympathize with my weakness? Because the Bible says that he was tempted in all ways as we are, yet without sin. That's not just a temptation to do the bad. It's temptation to quit. It's temptation just to, you know, call it off, you know, give up, do it, go in a different direction. Stop thinking about God. See, Jesus, he experienced incredible temptation. Satan brings him up to the highest points. If you're the Son of God, throw yourself off. You know, Satan whispering in the ear of Jesus Christ, and Satan will try to whisper in your ear too. But the Bible says that Jesus sympathizes with you. It's not like he just cries with you, and I believe that you could say, well, when I'm crying, is Jesus there? Of course he's there. But he's sympathizing in one sense. He is identifying at the deepest levels of your emotion. He is an identifier. He's the example. And J. Vernon McGee points out here, this is the six dangers that are possible in my life and yours. He says there are six danger signals in the book of Hebrews. They are warnings to the people of Israel that they fail not to enter into the full blessings which God has provided through Christ. These six danger signals can be likened to a highway markers to warn the reader. These danger signals are as follows. The peril of drifting. Just going back to your old ways. Remember when Israel's pulled out of Egypt and they're complaining about the manna? They're just grumbling, complaining people, okay? I do not like to be around grumbling, complaining people. They bring me down. They cause me to go low, and I'm trying to bring them high, okay? But they can wear you down. And when you have an entire nation of 6 million people who God just delivered out of incredible circumstances, and they're grumbling against God, that's a bad deal. That's a bad idea. But God is so long-suffering. So Israel complained, like, hey, when we were back in Egypt, at least we had like 3 meals a day, yeah? You guys were in bondage for 400 years, and the cry of my people has come before me, and I'm sending you a deliverer. He's pulling you out. I'm going to show you the miraculous, and later in the book of Judges, incredible account where Rahab the harlot says, we heard about you. The fear of you fell upon us. In other words, the God that you serve who delivered you out, you're here in our midst, we're dead. It's basically what she was saying. We are dead. And you see that a harlot, a prostitute, could be justified before God. Her behavior didn't identify her. Yeah, her behavior was bad. We don't know all the circumstances. But God, when God sees faith in him, he calls that person righteous. So just because maybe your life is messy, or you know people's lives who are messy, it doesn't mean that they're not saved. They yet have learned how to live successfully the Christian life by the control of the indwelling Holy Spirit. And they will often make disasters out of their life. Christians can frankly be dumb, okay? We've all been there, done that. We shouldn't do it, but we learn. And the book of Hebrews takes into account your humanity, your human weakness, and God knows all about it. He knows how you're tempted. He knows everything that we face. Anyway, back to J. Vernon McGee for a second. That would be the peril of drifting, Hebrews 2, chapter 1 to 4, which is where we're at right now. The peril of doubting. Oh, my goodness. Doubts. Like, I've talked to people in my time here as a pastor, and it's hard. Sometimes doubts are hard to shake. Sometimes, you know, my dad said to me, was really touching and yet a little scary, right before he passed, about 2 days before, he called me kind of in a panic. See, I tell my dad pretty much everything, okay? Hey, Dad, I performed a wedding ceremony today. This is all happening while he's in the hospital. So this is like 2 days before he passed away. My cell phone rings. It's him. Hey, Dave. Yes, Dad, what's up? I'm at home. He's up in Hingham. Am I supposed to perform a wedding today? I'm like, no, you're not. So his brain started to like get a little crazy because his blood disease was like depriving him of oxygen. But you know, we can get ourselves. So don't ever minimize somebody else's circumstances. You and I want to be good listeners to people, really attentive to what their struggle is. I'm learning the art of shutting up, okay? When somebody speaks and they're in pain, I want to be a good listener. I want to be a good listener. And Zachary, I have to tell you, my friend, when you called me on Friday, you made my day, okay? You made my day. You blessed me so much. Zach called me just to reach out. Hey, I'm thinking of you. I want to pray with you. I'm like, dude, you rock. I was so thankful. So the peril of doubting, because when we go low, it can sometimes, they can, you know, in other words, we all have had circumstances that can make us doubt. And I think this is my honest belief. Satan does his worst destruction in your life through doubting. That's his MO, get you to doubt God. And what happens to you? You're home sulking. Those people at that church don't like me. Yeah, we do, okay? We do love you. And we're going to continue to love you. But we need to stand for the truth, and we need to make sure that we can help overcome those areas of weakness that are likely to happen in all of our circumstances. So Hebrews is a warning against doubting. The peril of dull hearing. In other words, you hear the word of God, but it makes no difference in your life. That's called insensitivity. Well, why is that happening? Because probably you've let the doubts and the drifting continue to take over. And that would be Hebrews chapter 5, verses 11 to 14. The peril of departing. I'm done living this Christian life. I keep failing. Well, have at it. I mean, I don't want you to quit, and God's still not quitting on you. And I've known many people who've like thrown in the towel, and I have loved what one pastor says. I've thrown in the towel many times, and God threw it right back at me. That's a good one, right? So God's not done. He's never done. He's not done with you. You think like, I hit so low. I failed him. I doubted him. Yes, look at Peter. Peter is the picture of a person who experienced some of the most difficult failure any human being could ever overcome. And by the grace of God, Jesus wasn't done with him. And that's the same. That's the picture for you and for me. The peril of despising. In other words, you just stop. You don't want to hear the word of God anymore. You know, it's too convicting, or I don't like, you know, and you want to be careful. These are all very strong warnings that can happen to any of us. And then the peril of denying. Jesus Christ knows who belong to him. He knows them, right? Even if you feel like, I don't even know if I believe anymore. I mean, we've heard that one. You're going to come back. Remember what Jesus, I love that amazing story. Account in John chapter 6 where Jesus is speaking to his disciples, right? And the Bible says that he says, unless you eat of my flesh and drink of my blood, you have no part with me. He's not talking about communion, okay? A lot of people are like, that's a communion text. It's not. It's about ingesting him and his word and his truth and everything that he is. And the Bible says that many of his disciples, see, in Bible days, you are a disciple of so-and-so. You are a learner. You should have been a learner. Jesus comes on the scene, and Jesus gains disciples. It's not just the 12. Remember, he fed the multitude. The multitudes were there because he had something to say. The Bible says the common people heard him gladly. So he was sharing stuff, and people were like, I want to learn more about this guy. I'll follow him. And so there was a lot of times that Jesus had more than just the 12, and the 12 were that intimate group that are going to be ruling and reigning for all eternity, right? They're the names of the apostles are the foundation stones of the future city that you and I will dwell in. I mean, this whole thing is like we're just seeing a little snapshot now, what God is doing. And this snapshot, we just get stuck in it. It's like, it's my life. It's my life 9 to 5. It's my life at work. But you got an amazing future, believer. You've got a powerful, amazing future that the Bible says is going to happen. And you never want to lose your confidence. And so as we get into this book of Hebrews for just a few moments, I want to just read the text. And then we'll just look at why we're supposed to do these three things. The Bible says here that therefore we must give the more earnest heed to the things that we have heard, lest we drift away. For if the word spoken through angels proved steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just reward, how shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed by those who heard him? God also bearing witness both with signs and wonders and various miracles and gifts and the Holy Spirit according to his will. So on your handout, you might see these on the back. I really believe that the evidence stands and we are to listen to it. This is what God wants us to do. He wants us to listen to what he has to say to us. When I opened our service up today, I said, the Bible says, and this is Romans chapter 8, this is a wonderful companion chapter, I believe, to the book of Hebrews. Don't let God's correction in your life ever be something that causes you to doubt his love. You know, if you correct your child, is like, are you doing that because you hate your child? No. You correct because you love, and the same thing is with God. God can correct you, and you can still know that he loves me. Wow. Like, that's awesome. God can correct me, he can teach me, and he still loves me. So that's why we have to pull people out. Sometimes the scripture says to actually snatch some. Jude talks about snatching people, because false teachers can come into a person's life and they start messing with their brain. That's where Satan does his greatest work, is with your brain. It's getting you to think things that aren't biblical. And therefore, you start believing them. Or if you read scripture and the scripture's like, well, see what it says? Well, are you actually reading that in context? That's another good reason why you want to know the Bible. Because if you don't know the Bible in context, Satan has a lot to work with. So learn the books of the Bible. Learn to study. Learn. Paul told Timothy, show yourself approved, Timothy, a workman that needs not to be ashamed, rightly divide the word of truth. This Bible is a two-edged sword, the scripture says, and a sword can cut. If you mishandle the sword, you know what happens. It cuts. Sometimes you misuse the sword on your own life, and you can feel cut by it. If God be for me, who could be against me? You subject your life to that primary truth. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. Have you believed the gospel of Jesus Christ to save you? On that confession, on your belief in him, God has now something to work with. And he wants to work with you, not just throw you away because you failed. God knew what he took on. Isn't that cool? God knew. My dad is a picture of the grace of God. If you heard me share this morning, at 55 to 65 miles an hour, my dad he has an alcoholic seizure behind the wheel in 1982. Literally, every loaf of bread that he was about to be delivering at that time into every store on his route in the city of Boston was now all over him and all over the road. And that truck was completely and totally destroyed. They took the jaws of life, snatched my dad out. My dad stands up out of that truck, comes home that day. I see him. I'm like, Dad, I'm like 12 years old. Where's the truck? My Uncle Paul had picked him up. And I believe Uncle Paul and my dad's brothers will all be here on the 31st to see my dad get honored. And the word was, your dad crashed today. And I have come to really despise alcohol in my family. I don't like it. I know what it does. I've seen it. You know, I'm not condemning anybody here. As for me and my household, right, this is how I think. You know, I don't believe Christians should ever be drunk on alcohol, ever. The Bible says to be filled with the Spirit, right? Don't be drunk on the spirits, all right? Because I've seen a lot of stupidity, including my own family. I speak out of personal experience. I watch this stuff happen. And you know what? If you have to take a drink to get your thoughts, you know, away from, like, the bad stuff, well, you need to drink the Word of God. Drink the Psalms. Drink the comfort of the Scripture. And God will comfort you, and he'll put you in your right mind. My dad was in his right mind for the last 40 years. I watched him think clearly. I watched his life so different. And it's like, in my estimation, I'm like, you know what? I want to be like this guy. I want to be like him. I want to drive that truck and make him look good, okay? Anyway, all right. So we need to listen to the Word of God. Number one, therefore, we must give a more earnest heed to the things that we've heard, lest we drift away. In other words, pay attention. Keep in mind, The book of Hebrews is written to the Hebrews. Now, you can click, you can put yourself here for sure, but what we want to do when we read the Bible and we understand the scripture is look back and learn for who that was written to. God's teaching you now through his word. He wants you to see, like, this is what a wayward people do. People say, oh, the nation of Israel is so bad. Like, they were Christ rejectors and blah, blah, blah. And people, like, become anti-Semitic today. You tell me how you would have done with Jesus. You tell me if it was all put on us to do the right thing with him, would we have? I believe that ultimately God chose this nation as a picture of every human being who can be fickle, can be have everything done for them and still forget. And the nation of Israel always teaches the Christian. We are not Israel, okay? We are the church of the living God. Any person today, Jew, Gentile, calls upon the name of the Lord, is placed into this living organism called the church. You don't have to attend Grace Lighthouse Church to be there. You can be anywhere else. You could, but if you call upon Christ to save you, God has this group called the church. Yeah, do they all get it right at every local church? No, but God sees faith. And God has a plan with his church. He will accomplish. Jesus said, the gates of hell, I will build my church. The gates of hell will try to prevail, but they won't. They're knocking. Right? Satan's going to try to prevail against this incredible saved group of people on the earth. And we don't want to, you know, so when we think about Israel, we want to make sure that we're not beating them up for their bad decisions. They did. Sometimes, like, you know, why would Jesus say at times, like, you know, clean the speck out of your own eye, right? You know, or get the log out. You know, get that big honking thing out of there, because you can't see clearly here. And so before we just judge people for all their bad decisions, let's just make sure that, hey, by the grace of God, that'd be me, right? Are you agreeing with me? Because I'm about to go home. No. All right. So we want to, lest we drift away. So that's the warning here to the Hebrews. Therefore, we must give a more earnest heed to the things that we've heard. Now, the Hebrews heard, the children of Israel heard. Jesus shows up and God announces, this is my beloved son. Listen to him. And everything that Jesus' public ministry offered, his teaching, his miracles, everything was to show forth that, hey, this is God's gift in human flesh. This is a person. Jesus is not fake. He's a human being. He has the same type of stuff that you have, but he's sinless. He cannot sin. He does not have a sin nature. He was conceived of the Holy Spirit, born of God. And the Bible says that when you believe him, God sees you as brand new and born again. You're a new creation in Christ. Verses 2 and 3, we want to understand it. For if the word spoken through angels proved steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just reward, how shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation? This is the warning to the Hebrews. Do you guys realize all of the prophets, all of the record of the Old Testament scripture was given to them, and now they have Jesus show up, which they still reject him. Hello. Again, you show the heart of man can be so stubborn. You know, if you've noticed a pattern here in our church over these last like 8 weeks, how many people who shared testimonies, including the one that I read today, have been impacted by addiction, been impacted by all these types of things. And every person I know that's been transformed out of addiction often has a powerful testimony. It's like, wow, I see what God can do. And that's what this is ultimately saying. These people have been, God's saying, I provided a complete deliverance for you. How shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed to us by those who heard him? Remember what Peter says when he says that we heard him? We were with him on the holy mount. We went up there and Peter's like, Lord, is it good for us to be here? Jesus is completely transfigured in their sight. Jesus is like being right there in his veiled humanity. Like God just puts every holy spotlight on him. And Peter's like incredibly impacted by this. Like, Lord, there's three people here. You, Elijah, and Moses, I believe, representing the law and the prophets right there. Everything that would point to him. And Peter's like, should I build some shelters here? It's like that nakedness that we all feel sometimes, like exposed. I think that's exactly how Peter felt. Like, I am completely, I don't belong here. And that's why when the scripture says that over 500 people saw Jesus resurrected after he rose again, the scripture is based on eyewitnesses. So every time the scripture tells you to, when you think about this, the evidence has been presented to us as Christians. God provided this record to the world. We need to understand it. We need to listen to it. We need to understand it. And number three, we need to accept it. How shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation, which at first began to be spoken by the Lord? This is what God wants you and me to do, is to know who spoke. God never lies. He knows how to work with liars, okay? It doesn't reflect him. People want to throw God under the bus a lot. Like, oh, yeah, why does God let that happen? You know what? God has reasons to let things happen. I pulled at Romans 8:28 this week more times. I know that God causes all things to work out together for the good for those who love him and are called according to his purposes. Even in death, even when somebody's taken, even when something like you just don't want it to go that way happens, God can still work that out for your good and his glory. The question is, will you let him? The warning here is that because life is hard, don't drift. Don't go in the directions that are going to just cause you to, like, just feel defeated. I got enough history in my life to tell you that I understand depression. I understand weakness. I understand it all. Chances are, I'll probably be back there again from time to time. But I'm learning in my own life. I'm learning so much to let my trust be on this abiding word, because I know that God keeps his word and his promises. Amen? Amen? Amen. All right. We could go on a little bit longer, but I think we should transition here and honor the Lord by observing the Lord's Supper. I want you to know something this morning. When you take the Lord's Supper, you're not ingesting the body and the blood of Jesus Christ. What you are doing here is that you are remembering Jesus. You're remembering, taking communion does not give you eternal life. Jesus gives you eternal life. Every time you observe the Lord's Supper, you take the bread, you drink the cup, you're remembering what he did for you. In other words, his body was broken for you. This is a statement of love, love across your life. And the blood that was shed was given so that your sins would be completely covered by him. It's a win-win. Every time we observe, we get reminded, right? Every time we observe, we honor him. And that's what we're going to do right now. I've invited Aaron and Bill. They're going to first pass out the bread.